Okay, so let's get to this second session of Healing Diabetes Foundations, video number two, just making sure that it's recording here. So now let's find out what blocks glucose. In the previous session, we established that it's not about how much glucose or carbohydrates we eat, but rather about the inability of cells to take glucose into the cells. And so if we can fix that, then perhaps we can likely fix diabetes, right? So what blocks glucose? There are certain types of foods that do, and I'll talk about the most important food in this video session. Certain poisons do as well. Poisons from our food, from the environment, even from within the body. And I'll touch about that in the next video. Lack of certain nutrients can do that too. So certain nutrients are required for both the uptake of glucose. For example, potassium is very important here. And certain nutrients also help in the metabolism, the breakdown, and the extraction of energy out of glucose. And if we can't do that optimally, then it's harder for glucose to come into the cell. So finding out what nutrients might be missing and addressing that can be really important as well. Another example of something would block glucose is certain medications. A lot of people who are diabetic take multiple medications for different chronic diseases. And some of these medications can block glucose and contribute to diabetes. Again, I'll talk about it in the next video. And certain hormones can also interfere with the uptake in the metabolism of glucose. For example, under stress, a lot of stress hormones can do that too. And so let's get back to the topic of this video, which is the number one food blocker of glucose, and that's fat. And that's paradoxical also, especially if you follow the high fat, low carb diet. Perhaps you had some good results from that diet, at least initially. Talk about that soon. But the reason that fat blocks glucose is that the cell's two main sources of energy are either glucose, again, not a poison, as well as fat, or the components of fats and oils, fatty acids. But let's just use the word fat to keep it simple. And so your cells cannot use both at the same time. Certain cells can only use glucose, certain cells prefer fat, but cannot use both at the same time. So when fat enters the cells to be used as a source of energy, it blocks glucose, and that's called the Randall cycle. It blocks glucose, glucose cannot go in, more glucose stays in the blood vessels, and that's diabetes for you. Hopefully that makes sense. And so glucose is actually a preferred source of energy for most of the types of the cells in the body. Our brain alone needs 120 grams of glucose. So 120 grams of glucose, what's that? A bowl of rice can give you maybe 30, 40 grams of glucose. Fruit can give you 10 to 20 grams of glucose. You can see that just the brain alone needs quite a bit of carbohydrates. The blood, our blood needs 30 grams of glucose. And then most of the cells and most of the organs in the body prefer glucose over fat because glucose needs less oxygen. It's easier to be used as a source of fuel. And so really only muscle fibers use exclusively fat. Now we have a lot of muscles in our body and we can use that to our advantage. We want to lose weight. We can increase the strength of our muscles and help metabolize fat more efficiently. When we switch from a state of rest, like right now I'm sitting, my muscles are using fat, but if I would start exercising vigorously, my muscles will start using glucose and they get the glucose from within. So our muscles store glucose in a form of glycogen. Glycogen is for our muscles what starch is for plants. It's a storage form of glucose. And so that's where they get it from typically until they run out of glucose, unless we refeed and restore our glycogen stores. So hopefully you appreciate that concept, very important concept. Most types of organs, cells, and tissues in the body prefer glucose. And this is the reason for this piece of information I shared with you in the last video, that low-carb diets are unsafe and should be avoided. A lot of people feel good when they go on a low-carb, high-fat diet, at least initially. And in this study, they fed mice high-fat, low-carb diet, and it worked for a week or two. And past that period, the mice started becoming obese and developed diabetes. Paradoxically, on a low-carb diet, they started becoming obese. Why? Because of these concepts here, basically, okay? And a week in a lifetime of a mouse is equivalent to 9 months in a lifetime of a human being. And so different people, even when they respond well to a low-carb, high-fat diet, that effect, that feeling good, will last only so long, and then different issues start developing. They stop sleeping as well. They stop feeling as energetic anymore. Energy levels drop, which means they're not producing energy properly. And a variety of different health issues might develop, including the ones that are mentioned here. Over time, increased risk for different cardiovascular diseases, cancer, again, obesity and diabetes. Sooner or later also results in what? Not only in increased levels of glucose overall, and so indeed low carb diets sooner or later result in high glucose throughout the day, but also upon rising. And I'm just mentioning it because this is an interesting concept. Often when you follow a low carb diet, of course your dinner is low in carbohydrates, and yet often people wake up and they find out that their glucose levels start creeping up after a low carb diet over a period of time. And so I often hear these conversations, or these questions, I should say, why is that happening here? And people find out about something called the dawn phenomenon, where at 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, your body starts producing glucose because it runs out of glucose, right? You can only usually use the glucose from the meal before, but it runs out of it and it has to make its own. Now, this dawn phenomenon, which results in the body producing glucose from within, is applicable to everyone, not just diabetics. Also non-diabetic experience this phenomenon. It's just that in non-diabetics, glucose levels only rise so much. They don't rise to abnormal levels. So it's important to appreciate it. Again, people often chalk up the experience of suddenly experiencing, again, higher glucose levels after having them normalized for a while on a low carb diet to the dawn phenomenon. But it happens in both diabetics and non-diabetics. So I just wanted to make that point. So it's really important to address the underlying cause and find out what is blocking your glucose uptake and utilization and address that. So again, fat is a major blocker of glucose. And so the action plan that would result from that is avoid high fat foods, right? That's the step that you need to take. And so this slide represents different types of high fat foods. And you can see that a bunch of them are actually also starchy foods that are used with fats and oils. And so they're rich in fats and oils. And often people conflate a high carb diet with processed foods. And so, yeah, of course, you want to avoid these types of high carb processed foods because they're also rich in fats and oils. They're typically rich in the worst type of fat, and the worst type of fat, or fats and oils, are really one and the same in a sense. And I won't get into details right now, but the worst type of fat, so to speak, are the seed and vegetable oils, a group that I would refer to as seed oils or vegetable oils. Now, they're not made from vegetables. They're primarily made from seeds or legumes. So canola oil or sunflower seed oil, as well as things like soy, which is a legume, peanut butter oil is a legume. And so the issue is that these cause a chemical type of damage known as oxidative stress, contributing to the complications of diabetes. Indeed, oxidative stress can also block the uptake of glucose into the cells. And perhaps even more importantly, it can contribute to the types of complications that you see in diabetes, specifically things like heart attacks and strokes, kidney disease, loss of kidney function, loss of eyesight, and neuropathy, so tingling and burning and loss of sensation in the nerves. And the reason is that these types of oils, the fatty acids in these oils and their breakdown products, so the body uses them and it breaks them down to different things known as aldehydes, generally speaking, but I don't want to get into the chemistry here. And these things basically stick to the linings of the blood vessels and cause types of changes that may result in blockages. So when there's a blockage in arteries that feed the heart, it can result in a heart attack. If there are blockages to arteries that feed the brain, it can cause a stroke. When there are blockages to arteries that feed the kidneys, it can cause obviously kidney disease and loss of kidney function. And when it comes to arteries that feed the eyes, it can cause loss of eyesight. And of course, they can also stick to nerves. Nerves that feed the eyes, again, can contribute to loss of eyesight. And in general, when they stick to the nerves, can also cause neuropathy. I read about it, then I hear it, that it's glucose that sticks to the arteries. But if the capacity of seed oils and their breakdown products to stick to the arteries is 20 times greater than glucose capacity to stick to the arteries. Very important, try to avoid these, super important. We find them in, often people cook with them in the kitchens, find them in the restaurants, especially fast food restaurants, really most restaurants cook with them. And you find them in different types of snacks, right? The sort of things that you see in this slide as well. If you take these steps that I mentioned in this video, then it will go a long way towards helping you to reverse your diabetes. Okay, so let's find out in the next video what else blocks glucose and contributes to diabetes.